We hunger for so much, not so much for bread, though there are those among us who are hungry, not so much for wisdom, though we often lack it, not so much for compassion, though too often our focus is fixed upon ourselves. Why is it that we hunger for things that will not satisfy us? On the journey of Lent, we seek the living God, and we pray that God will give us hunger only for what can truly satisfy the soul. The goodness of simple things like bread, the wisdom that leads to honest living, the compassion that connects us to one another. Then, indeed, we will be grateful for all that really matters. This day, Christ invites you to follow him. Take the journey. Friends, if you're able, please rise and join us in our first hymn this morning. Confession. Loving God, you have given us all that we need to live a full and abundant life. Yet sometimes we hunger for all the wrong things. We turn away from you and seek happiness in empty pursuits and temporary pleasures. Sometimes we forget that there is no fulfillment without serving others, no gladness without a purpose greater than ourselves, no joy without love. Lord, this day, let us see our own lives as they truly are, and our own need for the fulfillment, gladness, and joy that are your gift to us in Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, like a loving father, God is waiting to welcome us home. Like a caring mother, God will not forsake us. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In Christ, we have a new opportunity each and every day to live the good life that is God's gift. Amen. Well, welcome to worship here at Christ Presbyterian Church in La Costa, California, and also those of us joining us online. We're delighted that you are here. We have a very important question to ask this morning. Do you all like green eggs and ham? Would you eat them with Sam I Am? Yesterday was Dr. Seuss Day, and he would have celebrated his 120th birthday. So We're going to continue to ask that age-old question, and I would invite you to rise and greet your neighbors and find out if they would indeed eat green eggs and ham with Sam I Am. Hi. What was the consensus?
The consensus is go drink anything and eat anything green.
Okay. Oh, that's great.
Yes. I do. I like green eggs and ham. I do. I like them, Eileen I Am. Just a few announcements here today. And first, we're going to hear from Elder Dick Dietrich of our Property and Finance Committee. Dick?
Good morning. And as a way of introduction, I'm a 9 o'clock person, so it's nice to see you all today. I'm here this morning to discuss our operating budget. But first, I want to mention the theme song from the musical Annie, "The Sun Will Come Out Tomorrow." Not only does it express our faithful expectation 27 days from today, it expresses our expectation for bright days to come. This is especially relevant as we continue to recover from the effects of the pandemic and inflation. CPC's operating budget this year includes a 17% deficit. That is, at the beginning of the fiscal year, we expected to receive $110,000 less than the cost of operations. But the sun is coming out. As of the end of February, giving is almost $60,000 more than anticipated. So more than half of our deficit is gone. Many of you have been making over and above gifts to our church. That really makes a difference. Thank you. With more over and above gifts by the end of the fiscal year on June 30th, we can make an even bigger dent. Although not everyone can do that, every gift helps. What better place to give our money than to this church that is making a difference in our corner of the world? Throughout our collective contributions of time, talent, and treasure, we help others to see the presence of the sun in the world today, tomorrow, and every day. Thank you.
Thank you, Dick. And thanks to all of you for generous giving that makes a difference in the church and, yes, indeed, and enables this church to make a difference. So, a week from this Friday is the usual third Friday, Friday with Friends, but it's March 15th, which is close enough to make it a St. Patrick's Day potluck. And dinner will be, we start at 4:30, you can come anytime. There's fellowship time. There will be an Irish story a little earlier than usual at 5, and then dinner, 5:30, and corned beef and cabbage and boiled potatoes are going to be provided. I mean, this is the best deal in town, believe me. So you can bring appetizers, dessert, that kind of thing, but it's a wonderful opportunity to gather for some fellowship, and you can wear green or orange if you insist on being defiant. Now we have a very special Minute for Mission that comes to us by the magic of video. And this is Beth Hergesheimer.
I'd like to invite you to participate in an evening of community conversation at Christ Presbyterian Church on March 13th. During my years as a school board member, I witnessed the decline in the ability of our community to have conversations where they could find common ground or accept that they might need to meet each other halfway. And we need to be able to talk to each other about topics that are important to us, to our community, to our state, and to our nation. The Art of Inquiry workshop that was held at our church a few weeks ago was a good start in learning some skills to do that. But whether you participated in that workshop or not, you're invited to this upcoming evening. It will be different than a debate you might have in your office or at the water cooler or at a family Thanksgiving dinner. We'll meet in small groups. the conversation will be structured so that each person gets an opportunity to speak about something that matters to them, uninterrupted, and without debate. The purpose will be to understand each other, not to persuade each other. And it's in the hopes that we'll build community and that we will have an opportunity to listen to what matters most to all of us. There won't be winners or losers. We'll leave with a better understanding of what each other thinks and believes and why, and hopefully a better understanding of ourselves and why we are believing what we speak to. Again, I valued the skills that were taught at the Art of Inquiry program and the opportunity we had to learn and exercise those. So I hope that you will find the same value in accepting my invitation to come to the evening of community conversation on Wednesday, March 13th from 6:30 to 9 p.m. You can sign up in the lobby or you can go online to the church website, and I hope we will see you there.
Thank you, Beth. That's an evening of community conversation,
and
it's really the church trying to say, we're not just going to sit out what's going on in our country. Let's find a way to really talk and really communicate in ways that are helpful. And it's a Wednesday night, the March 13th, 6:30 to 9. And if driving at night's a problem, let us know. We'll arrange a pickup. We can do that. Anyway, it should be a really good and a healthy conversation in a really good way when everybody leaves feeling good about what we've said and what we've heard. Anyway, so there's another sign up out there in the lobby for the women's retreat, the weekend of May 17th through 19th, and you can learn more about it at the table afterwards, too. Last but not least, Palm Sunday is just 3 Sundays away, and we have an Easter egg hunt, egg venture that day, and we need some things for that, and those are listed in the bulletin as well. Now I'd like to invite the kids to join Eileen on the steps.
All right. Hi, friends. Good morning. Good morning. All right. Good morning, everybody. Well, today, I don't know if you all noticed, but we have a meal set up on the communion table. We have the bread and we have juice. And in a little while, we're going to take communion in here. And Pastor Greg is actually going to talk about something really important that Jesus said. Did you know that Jesus, he was talking to his friends and he said, I am the bread of life. And his friends were like, wow, that's pretty cool. And maybe they were a little confused too. But Jesus said, I am the bread of life. And we're going to pray the prayer that Jesus taught, in which it says, give us our bread, our daily bread. And I want to tell you guys that's something really interesting, where it says, give us our daily bread. Does anybody hear that's for everybody? It doesn't say, just give me my own bread. It says, give everybody, give us all bread, because Jesus wants us to know that when it comes to what we need to keep going in life, I mean, you guys, most of you eat food every day, I'm assuming, yes, hopefully, because we need food and it helps sustain our bodies and our lives. And Jesus says, I want to make sure that everybody knows that this earth was created in a way that everybody should have daily bread. And something is really cool happening at our church this week. Starting today, we're going to have some guests come and stay with us. And as the church, we're going to do exactly what Jesus asked us to do. We're going to provide daily meals. We're going to provide a safe and warm place for people to sleep for the next 2 weeks. And we're going to welcome them every single day to have a meal with them. In fact, there were signups out there that a lot of the people from the church have agreed that they're going to come and actually cook that meal, and then they're going to enjoy it with these folks. And hopefully by the end, they're going to become friends of ours because we're going to get to know them. Because Jesus says, not only are we all invited to come to the table, but he hopes that we will also invite others to come to that same table. And when we do that, we fulfill what Jesus asked us to do, which is to be good friends who love others well. So I hope that you all will find ways to do that this week too. Will you pray with me? God, thank you that you invite all of us to come to the table and that you are the bread of very good life. And I pray that we would be filled in such a way that we go out and we love others the way you've asked us to. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bye, guys.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Every color, shape, and size, they are precious in his eyes. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Jesus most certainly does. We have a lengthy prayer list today, and so we will lift all of those folks up there. No special updates except for one, that D.O. Wolf is home after 3 weeks in IVR healthcare. We pray that he'll continue his recovery and regaining strength. So prayers for him and for all those on our prayer list. We hold them in the light, God's healing light that brings grace and love and healing graces. So bless each and every one. We pray for our guests at the Interfaith Homeless Shelter who will be staying here on our campus in the Education Building for the next 2 weeks. They'll be arriving this afternoon, 8 men and women and 1 child, I believe. And that number could vary during the week as someone perhaps finds a home or perhaps or more folks come to stay. But we pray for them. Some of them have jobs. Some of them need jobs. All of them need a place, a permanent place to stay. So we pray for them. And we're grateful to all of you for making this possible with being overnight host or providing dinner or all the supplies that are needed. All those needs have been met. The bulletin says we had one dinner left to fill, but our friends at the Jewish Collaborative next door, the synagogue next door, they're covering that dinner for us. All the needs have been covered, and we're grateful to all of you for doing that. We pray for the people of Ukraine, entering a third year now of war. We pray for soldiers and citizens at risk on all sides. We pray for the things that make for peace there. We pray for Palestinians and Israelis after months now of just terrible violence and terrible loss of life, and for the glimmers of the hope of perhaps a ceasefire. That are there right now, and with the hope that should that happen, that ceasefire would turn into a path toward a real peace, and accompanied by such justice as can be found now in this difficult time. We pray for our Muslim and Jewish friends, our Jewish friends next door, our Muslim friends at the Tri-City Islamic Center, with whom we've partnered for many years now, for whom this continues to be a really difficult and painful time. But they do appreciate that we pray for them. And I tell them we pray every week for them, and the challenge it is to be here, knowing that such difficulties and terrors are happening there. We pray for all the places in our world that do not know what makes for peace, that where bullets and bombs are just all too present realities. This afternoon, there's a gathering for Hands of Peace, and Hands of Peace, as most of you know, is that a rather remarkable organization for the last 20 years has brought Israeli and Palestinian young adults to Chicago and to San Diego for the last 10 years to meet with American young adults to plant seeds for peace. And that organization is ending as of the end of this month. But they're passing the baton to a group that's been around just a little bit longer, Seeds of Peace. It has a very similar mission, and the Seeds of Peace has agreed to welcome all the alumni of Hands of Peace, those young adults we've had in our sanctuary pretty much every summer for the last 9 years. They're welcoming those young adults into their alumni fold, so they'll have a fellowship following up with them as they continue to work for peace in various places and stages where they find themselves in Israel, Palestine. So we pray a prayer of gratitude for Hands of Peace and for all those 800-some alumni who will be continuing to work for peace wherever God places them. And now Carol will lead us in the prayers of the people.
Good morning. Please join me in prayer. Lord, we live in troubling times. We worry about violence and strife in our nation and in the world. We're concerned about our loved ones, the illnesses and challenges they face. We worry about the future and the continuity of our planet. But when we worry, Lord, we're not trusting you for the blessed outcomes you have for us. Lord, we lift up all of our worries and we lay them at your feet. We know that God's got this. Your thoughts are higher than our thoughts and your ways better than our ways. Give us the trust and faith to know that all will be well. All will be very well. God of all blessings, source of all life, giver of all grace, we thank you for the gift of life, for the breath that sustains life, for the food of this earth that nurtures life, for the love of family and friends without which there would be no life. We thank you for the mystery of creation, for the beauty that the eye can see, for the joy that the ear may hear, for the unknown that we cannot behold. We thank you for setting us in communities, for families who nurture our becoming, for friends who love us by choice, for companions at work who share our burdens and daily tasks, for strangers who welcome us into their midst, for people from other lands and cultures who call us to grow in understanding, for children who lighten our moments with delight, for the unborn who offer us hope for the future. We thank you for this day, for life, for one more day to love and be loved, for the opportunity to serve you and your people, for your grace and the one more experience of your presence, for your promise to be with us, to be our God, and to give us salvation. For these and all blessings, we give you thanks, eternal loving God. Now, knowing that you value our prayers, we pray the prayer that your blessed Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sin.
Such a beautiful hymn. We're continuing our series on the I am sayings in the Gospel of John. For only in John do we hear these words like, I am the light of the world. I am the good shepherd. And today, I am the bread of life. When I was younger, John was my least favorite gospel. For reasons we could discuss another time, John is probably the least historically accurate of the four gospels, if you want to get into the details and the nitty-gritty. And at the time, I wanted the most accurate, the most historically factual. That was the most important thing to me. In my college days, there was a member of my home church in Wheaton, Illinois, who was a federal judge. And later I learned that he was a pretty prominent judge, that in the 1970s he had ordered the Chicago Police Department to hire women, and that he had ordered them to take action against discriminating against blacks and Hispanics in the police department. And he sent a union boss to jail. I mean, he was in some pretty prominent cases. But back then I only knew him as the summer speaker in a Wednesday night series of gatherings of 10 or 20 people in the church garden, little informal worship services, and he was the preacher at one. And Judge Prentice Marshall was reading from the Gospel of John one Wednesday night when he noted that Matthew and Mark and Luke were like photographs, but John was like a painting. Sometimes a photograph is the most accurate depiction of a person, but sometimes, the judge said, a painting reveals more than a photograph ever could. And the Gospel of John was a painting, he said, a glorious painting that reveals much of the mystery of who Jesus is, much of the nitty-gritty but genuine love to be found in him. And it was the painting the judge preferred, he said. Maybe if I'd seen the self-portraits of Vincent van Gogh back then, I might have understood what he was talking about. But I had not, and I did not. So it was many years before I realized the truth in what he was saying. Interestingly enough, though, I remembered it all these years. But it was years before I really got it, what he meant. And now I love the Gospel of John for the portrait of Christ that he paints there, for the depth and the beauty and the life to be found in it. And I hope that you love the Gospel of John too. We're reading today from the 6th chapter of the Gospel of John, which interestingly enough is where we hear about communion in John's Gospel. Because in John's Gospel, unlike Matthew, Mark, and Luke, where the Last Supper is where we hear about communion, the bread and the wine are the body and the blood of Christ, John doesn't talk about that at the Last Supper. The Last Supper in John talks about the washing of the feet of the disciples, this act of service that we're all called to imitate. But there's nothing about the Passover dinner, about the bread and the wine. No, that discussion in John takes place in the 6th chapter. In the 6th chapter. So in the other Gospels, talking about communion happens in the shadow of the cross, because the day after the Last Supper is the day Jesus is crucified. But in John's Gospel, it's not like that at all. In John's Gospel, he's talking about communion and the bread of life, as we'll see in a moment. He talks about that right after the feeding of the 5,000. 5,000 people fed by 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. That's where he starts talking about the bread of life. So John has a whole different take about it. Surely he knew about the original Last Supper, what happened there. But he doesn't tell that story. Instead, he tells it here, after the feeding of the 5,000, which is one of the most amazing miracles, the only one that's told in all 4 Gospels. Although John doesn't call it a miracle, he doesn't use the word miracle. John uses the word sign. A sign reveals something that's more than what you initially see. So there's more to the feeding of the 5,000, this bread and fish that feed all these people. There's more going on, John, the gospel writer, wants you to know. And Jesus is about to tell us all about it. All about it. It turns out there's a lot more to the feeding of the 5,000 than we think. So here's the story. After the people have been fed on the mountainside with the bread, fish, 12 baskets of it all left over, Jesus and his disciples take a night boat across the Sea of Galilee, which is sometimes called a lake. They take a boat. It's a little more detailed than that. Jesus ends up walking on the water for half of the trip. But again, we'll save that story for a different time. Anyway, this night trip, they end up over here in Capernaum. In the morning, the people wake up, and they notice that Jesus is gone. Jesus isn't there anymore, and they want more. They want more. So they follow him across the Sea of Galilee in their own boat. I don't know. All 5,000? I don't know. It just says the people follow him across in their boat. And then we hear what happens as we read the story. In the 6th chapter, we're going to begin with the 25th verse. So hear the word of God. When the people found Jesus on the other side of the lake, the Sea of Galilee, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" And Jesus answered them. He doesn't really answer them. He gives them he takes the conversation in a different way. "When did you get here?" they say. Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves." Human nature hasn't changed a bit, right? These folks are there for brunch. They're not interested in anything more than what will fill their stomachs for another day. They don't even realize that Jesus has showed them a sign, even though Jesus uses the word. But he's about to tell them. Back to the scripture. "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life," Jesus said, "which the Son of God, the Son of Man, will give you. For it is on him," the Son of Man, this is Jesus talking about himself in the third person, "for it is on Jesus, the Son of God, that God the Father has set his seal." So Jesus starts laying his cards out on the table to show them there's more going on here than just this little lunch that you just had. There's a different kind of a food, Jesus is saying, something that will feed you forever. That's what I'm really offering you here, not some kind of a lunch special. Back to the scripture. Then the people said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" And Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom God has sent." So the people said to him, "What sign are you going to give us so that we may see and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus puts another card on the table. It's about believing in God, believing in the one whom God has sent, as the Gospel of John will tell us over and over and over again. But the people want another sign. Did you hear that? What sign are you going to offer us? Apparently, the feeding of the 5,000 is just not enough. They even give Jesus some advice. "You know, don't you, Jesus, that Moses gave our ancestors manna, bread, in the wilderness, in the desert, after they escaped from slavery in Egypt? You might give us something like that if you're someone like Moses." Like Jesus needs the help, right? Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Oh, my friends," Jesus says, "don't you know that the bread from heaven in the wilderness did not come from Moses, that it came directly from God?" Now Jesus shows his whole hand, except he holds one last card back. But all the rest of the cards, he plays them right out for everyone to see. "You've already received the only sign that you'll ever need. That bread yesterday on the mountainside, that was just a foretaste. Just a foretaste of the bread that lasts forever. This bread that lasts forever is much more than manna in the wilderness. This bread has come down from heaven to give life not only to you, but to the whole world." Then they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." I like to think they're starting to get it. Jesus, if you're telling us there's a bread that is genuinely soul food, if that's what you're telling us, then give us some. Give us some always. And then Jesus plays that last card, the last verse of our scripture today. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. There it is, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There it is, the sign you're looking for is right here in front of you. I'm the sign, Jesus says. I am the sign. I am the bread of life. Come to me, you'll never be hungry, never be thirsty. The soul food I'm offering you will last forever. What are we hungry for, really? What is it that we thirst after? When you put the question that way, it's pretty clear, really, isn't it, that it's not just normal bread. It's more than food. When Jesus is tempted in the wilderness, remember Jesus says, human beings do not live by bread alone. We all know that. We thirst for so much more than just liquid refreshment. Our deepest longings, they may be beyond words, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't use words to try to describe them. Belonging. We hunger for purpose. We thirst after aliveness. We hunger for courage, for freedom, for accomplishment, for doing something that matters with this life that we have. We hunger for love, giving it and receiving it. We hunger and thirst for any of these, all of these, and more. If you stop to think about it, you might come up with your own list of what it is especially that you hunger for, that you thirst after. Let's not underestimate the basic level of the sign. Without literal food, we will die. Without actual water, we will perish. But it's also true that to live without belonging, to live without purpose, to live without aliveness, without courage, without freedom, without love, is to live in some form of death. In the first letter of the Gospel of John, perhaps written by the same person who wrote the Gospel, the first letter of John says, he who does not love remains in death. You're not fully alive if you don't love. In the face of this deep hunger, this intense thirst, Jesus dares to say, he dares to say, I am the bread of life. If you come to me, your hunger will be met. Your thirst will be satisfied. What does he mean by that? Well, surely as the Gospel of John, the things Jesus says work on many levels. So maybe you will want today to think about what it means to you for Jesus to say those things to you in your life, where you are. To me, I think they're at least a sign that if you come to Jesus, you'll never be hungry, never be thirsty. At one level means that the life Jesus offers you is the only life that matters. And to me, there are two dimensions to that life. First, that life is a gift to be experienced, to be appreciated, to be enjoyed, to be savored. Life is a gift to be lived. But just to stop there, as too many people do, is to miss the deeper purpose. because this gift of life has to be shared, it has to be given away. We're blessed to be a blessing. It's a principle you find all through the scripture. God says it to Abraham and Sarah in the 12th chapter of the first book of the Bible. We are blessed in order to be a blessing. And if you skip the second half of that, then you've missed the whole thing. They belong together to enjoy this good life and to share it. Either without the other isn't nearly enough. As the proverb once seen on a church signboard out in front of a church says, if you have been blessed with good fortune, build a bigger table, not a higher fence. But let's not leave it there. Let's go along with John. Let's see, try to go a little bit deeper. What is Jesus meaning when he says, I am the bread of life? In these troubled times, we're looking for hope. Where is hope to be found in this understanding of Jesus as the bread of life? Some of you will remember Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. She was a psychiatrist and a co-founder of the hospice movement. And she was one of the first people, maybe the first, to study the dying process by talking directly with people who were in it, who were in the process of dying. 70 years ago, her classic book, On Death and Dying, was published, and it is still in print. From that perspective, of all that she learned from people themselves, she offered these wise words on living in an interview years later. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross said, The most beautiful people we have known are those who have known defeat, who have known suffering, who have known struggle, who have known loss, and have found their way out of the depths. These people have an appreciation, a sensitivity, and an understanding of life that fills them with compassion, gentleness, and a deep, loving concern. Beautiful people do not just happen. Beautiful people do not just happen. When Jesus says, I am the bread of life, he is speaking to those who have known defeat, who've known suffering, who've known sorrow, who've known failure, who've known betrayal, who've known all those things. He's speaking to all of us. And he's offering a way out of the depths. And we can trust that Jesus knows the way out of the depths because he has been there. Because there is no sorrow, no failure, no betrayal, no loss, no suffering, no injustice, no heartbreak that Jesus himself has not known. And the way out, the only way out, really, is to trust that there's something more. To trust that there is love at the heart of the universe. To trust that that love will pull us through whatever it is that we're facing. To trust that there is a love that will not let us go. And surely the story of Jesus is all about Jesus offering us his hand to pull us through and not ever to let us go. That's how we become beautiful, according to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. That's how we become beautiful, according to Jesus. It's also the way that the world will become beautiful again. When Jesus says to us, not only to ancient disciples, not only to generations past, when Jesus says to you and to me, I am the bread of life, he's saying that we can come to him and trust him with our broken, messed up lives, and that he will give us what we need to repair them, to restore them, to renew them. Whether we're a little lost or a lot lost, whether we've lost a little or lost a lot, the bread of life will heal, will help, and in the end, after a journey, will make us whole, whole in the broken places. Maybe you know what you need. When you come forward today for communion, you may know exactly what it is you need to be whole. Forgiveness, repair, courage, strength. If you know what you need, when you come forward to receive the bread of life in a few moments, ask for it. Ask for it and trust that it will be given to you. Maybe you don't know. Maybe you don't know what it is you need to be whole. Maybe you sense there's something missing. Maybe you're so broken you don't know where to start. Maybe you think everything is just perfect, just fine the way it is, which could be the riskiest place of all to be. When you come forward, then just bring yourself. Just bring yourself. And trust that the bread of life will meet you where you are, even if you don't know where that is. Trust that the bread of life will make you whole. Trust that the bread of life will make you, yes, beautiful. And trust that the bread of life will somehow, someday, make this whole world whole and beautiful again. For Christ's sake, and the world's sake, and our own sakes too. Amen. Let's worship God now with our gifts and with the gift of song. God's people say, amen.
Hear the words of our Lord Jesus. Come to me, all who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Friends, this is the table of our Lord, and our Savior invites all who trust in him, whether members of this congregation or not, to come and receive the bread of life and the cup of salvation.
Let us pray. God of grace, you welcome us to this, your table, reminding us that our one true home is with you. Wherever we go on our life journey, there you are before us to guide us, beside us to encourage us, and within us with gifts of mercy and courage and peace and hope. We thank you for our Savior Jesus, who journeyed on this earth as we do, who knew his life as we do with all the joys and sorrows, and who gave his life for ours on the cross. We rejoice that death could not hold him, that on Easter Day you raised him from the dead so that we would know that your last word for us and for all creation is not death, but life. So send your Holy Spirit now, O Lord, upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that in sharing them, we may be made whole, we may be made beautiful by the presence of our Savior and his love within us. And so, O Lord, we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels and with prophets, apostles, and the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Remembering your love for all creation, we break bread and share one cup. As you have raised our Lord from death and call us with him from death to life, we give ourselves to you to live for him in joy and praise. This is the Christ of God who takes away the sins of the world. Glad are those who are called to his table.
Christ has died.
All glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen, 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 amen.
And now we pray as our Savior taught us, singing together.
As it is.
And so on the night of his arrest, our Lord gathered with friends, as we have gathered, and he took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. For you. For you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is a new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this cup, do so in remembrance of me. For when you eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim our Lord's death until he comes again."
Will those serving communion please come forward? We'll receive communion by coming forward down the center aisle, taking the bread and cup, and partaking as you receive them, and then you may return to your seats down the outside aisle. If it's difficult for you to come forward, we will serve you where you're seated. All is prepared. Let us keep the feast. Thank you.
Gracious God, we thank you for this supper, shared with you and with your people. Send us forth from this place filled with your presence, your power, and your peace, so we may love you by serving one another in Christ's name. Amen.
So let us remember that life is short, and we have but little time to gladden the hearts of those who travel with us. So let us be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you, with those whom you love, and with those whom God loves, which is all of us and each of us, every single one. Amen. Let's rise as we sing.